probably pretty boring slides, black and white, no fancy pictures. We just did a changeover at work from bind DLZ, which uses a DB backend, to PowerDNS. So this is going to be covering what we, the kind of research we did to do that change. Target users for this sort of stuff, anybody with a ton of domains, basically. Large ISPs, web hosting companies. So if you're using flat files, you can probably use a database for, especially if you're going to give your users web interfaces to edit stuff. You really, really don't want them editing flat files that way. Interesting errors, especially because that file is then going to have to be changed. You're going to have to chown or run something as root. Lots of holes. Right. So that's why you use a database. Basically, I looked at just three options when I was, three things when I was looking at a server. Well, most of the things we are looking at were working accurately. So it was a question of whether the server is stable enough to deal with a large number of queries. High performance, because when you have got something like a few 100,000 domains, you do tend to get a lot of hits. And support if needed, what sort of community we had, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Basic options we looked at were raw bind, bind DLZ, and power DNS. Bind has a minor problem. Oh, yeah, this is why we don't do the flat files bit. That startup times is interesting for raw bind. Just over an hour. It's only 113K domains. And takes slightly over an hour to start. And uses up about, I think, 2 gigs of memory. Well, at 2 gigs, it didn't swap. At anything less than that, it was hitting swap. So after that, it's, once it gets memory in RAM, it's extremely happy. 30,000 QPS. PowerDNS is slightly more optimized to read bind files. Takes only 6 minutes for the same number of zones. Native bind is getting some alpha sort of support for DNS. It just uses one connection to the backend for each zone that you configure. Right, lots of zones, lots of DB connections. Not happening. Oh, and it doesn't do any in-memory caching either. So bind DLZ is a patch to the bind source code. You can download it from there. Uses a couple of connections and absolutely no caching. It has a very, very specific format that's documented out there for your queries, but you can choose to define your own schemas. Supports MySQL, Postgres, OpenLDAP, BDB. I'm not sure if it still does, if it does SQLite. The advantages that you have with, okay, that's the architecture, that's what it looks like. DLZ patch, talking directly to the DBMS. The benefits, fewer connections, one table. Keeps it extremely simple. Disadvantages is lousy, lousy performance. We were getting, I'll put up the numbers later, but it's somewhere in the low thousands for the numbers. And it is a third party patch to bind. Okay, how many people here have read the bind source code? Oh good, nobody has. Don't. Well, you could read it and possibly go insane. It is pure object-oriented code done in C with all kinds of function pointer mappings to be able to implement virtual tables. PowerDNS is a DNS server written in C++. The code here is modular and clean. Well, that's C++ code and it's still clean. Separate authoritative and recursive servers. The guy likes security. So he doesn't do a lot of things that bind does. If you need them to be on the same host, you can tell the authoritative server, here's a recursive resolver where you can need to go to. But otherwise, in my particular case, I really didn't have that requirement. I needed purely authoritative stuff. The focus on security was fairly good. We don't have too many bugs there. PowerDNS has an interesting feature. It has a cache. So you hit the DB, after which stuff goes straight into the cache. And after that, data is served from the cache for as long as you want it to be. We configured TTLs of about a week while we were testing, and we are running at 1 day in production. So even if there is a glitch with the cache management scripts, worst case scenario, your data gets expired out after a day, and write data gets served anyway. Major benefits, the footprint is low. With a million domains, it was using something like 400 megs of RAM. You still need two memory, you need the two tables bit, and it still doesn't do DNSSEC and views. If you need that, if you need either one of those two features for your authoritative servers, you're stuck with bind. Lies, damn lies, statistics. And then there are benchmarks. You will have to test out on your own hardware for what you want to do. But it's a fairly simple test. You just need the hardware. Native bind is not going to be useful. So we basically said flat file and see, let's look at the numbers. Testing infrastructure, one host, dual core, dual Xeon, 2-point-something gigahertz. You're basically going to block on CPU anyway, and bind uses only a single core at any given time. Clients, Pentium boxes, they were completely not loaded. We couldn't max out anything on the boxes by even with the client running. That was the QueryPerf thingy. QueryPerf is a tool that ships with bind source code, by the way. So if you want to get QueryPerf, you'll have to get source. Numbers, this is where it starts to get interesting. DLZ with the BDB driver. Two QueryPerf threads with two threads doing the BDB stuff. 5600 QPS, fairly nice. When we did PostgreSQL with raw queries, 1800 QPS, and with stored procedures, 2000. Like I said, it's a order of magnitude drop, low thousands. Bind DLZ PostgreSQL with the 8th thread as a compile option, we managed to show it up to 4800 QPS. We tested out Nominum. Nice performance. For the price, ow! 6 digits, US dollars. I'm suddenly not sure I want to do that. Raw bind itself would work if you could get it to start up fast enough. So we went and looked at PowerDNS, which had support. So at that time, the default cache was a hash map. So O1, as long as your hash doesn't get full. 115K domains, the hash is extremely nice. Still, you're getting 20,000 QPS. So we decided to load it up some more. Generate 3 million domain names, each with 2 NS records, 1 SOA, 1 MX, and 1 A record. Show it all into the DB, and PDNS is serving it at 7,000 QPS. That sucks. So we assigned a developer to do some work, see if we could figure out a better hashing algorithm, and finally gave up. We basically said that won't work. So we went and talked to the developer, paid him to replace the cache. So he dropped in a red black tree in there. The cache was still single threaded, and regardless of the number of domains, it was still doing 2100 QPS. But the problem is, once you have loaded up the box and everything is in cache, it just uses one CPU, one core. And we have multi-core boxes. No sense in wasting the remaining core, so we asked him to implement a threaded cache. And that drove the performance up slightly higher, 46,000 QPS. Two CPUs with two cores each. So four cores. This is Xeons. And this is basically 46,000 QPS, which is fairly decent performance for something that's supposed to be running a ccTLD. That's currently still in RC4. Release candidate 4, it's not been officially released yet. But we are running it in production, it's been running stably, as in there have been no crashes, it survived at least 3 DDoS attacks. And if you look at the graphs, operationally, this is the interesting bit, because this is something that nobody else really does. There are a lot of people who, even including the .org TLD, which basically goes all the way for DNS for various points, and then at the last bit, it basically flat files out. What we are doing is running it directly off the DB. This is all PostgreSQL. The masters and the slave, one of the master and one of the slaves sit in one of the data centers. We have set up Sloane as a replication system. Sloane is basically a PostgreSQL add-on system which does replication. The slaves are all read-only copies. Maximum differential time between master to slave is, 30 seconds. And we serve data, we read it only of the slaves. There is a management script, which is basically a Java program that hits the cache and expires it. If there is any change, that is basically logged into a separate table on the master, which say, and the script runs on each of the power DNS boxes, reads it from the DB, and simply deletes the entire zone. We could delete a single record if we had to, but the developer decided that it was just easier to delete the entire zone instead of trying to figure out how, here's this record and what else is affected by it. Especially if you're going to have wildcard records, that's useful. Just take out the zone. Most people tend to go flat file at the end. We are looking at lots of small domains, so we basically need it to run off the DB. Initial copy from the master to DC3, that went over 100 Mbit network and took us about 5 hours. But while we were doing that, we simply had Power DNS pointed to the other DB, directly connected to the slave in DC2. And it kept on serving data. Slightly slow, but it worked. We just lost the cache in between. And yeah, it's currently running around very, very happily. Now, questions?
Is the cache on PowerDNS persistent after restart? So if you restart, okay.
It's not a persistent cache, it's in memory. But essentially, it's just that you end up hitting the DB each time you restart PowerDNS, but you don't have to.
You mentioned a management script. Is that part of the PowerDNS? Is that something you locally developed and stuff?
That's something we locally developed.
Okay. So.
It's a fairly trivial one-liner script, but cache management, essentially, if you're doing a single host, is just fine. It's when you're going across continents and want to say that I need to be able to do stuff that is slightly not, that's a more complex architecture than most people run. Because at the end of the day, I could just expire it directly. We had to deal with the fact that we might have network failures in between and things like that. So each instance has to run its own script and say, okay, I've gone up to this point in the deletion bit.
When you're doing the slave replication initially with Sloane, is the bottleneck simply the network?
Just a lot of data to be copied over. We had something like about 3 gigs of raw data being copied over at 100 Mbps. Can't do much about that.
This is a bit off topic, but how well does the GeoDNS bits interact with the database stuff? Are you using that at all? Are you using the GeoDNS balancing at all?
At the moment, no.
No? Okay. Oh.
Right now, all these servers are sitting in the US, but we aren't doing any kind of Anycast at this point. The plans are to do some sort of Anycast, but that's still talks are on type situation. So, and it deals with, that's basically, we just have a local copy of the DB anyway, to whatever data center you want to go to. That still needs a public IP anyway. PowerDNS can keep the same IP and listen on the same IP. For what it's worth, you can use the same table structures with bind at DLZ and PowerDNS. Just that the queries are slightly different. PowerDNS has one restriction that you cannot have a dot at the end. of your record name, and it always wants a fully qualified record. BindDLZ does not care about the fully qualified record bit, but it wants a dot at the end if there is a dot anywhere else. So that's just a question of writing your own, of specifying the dot in the query or not. Anything else? No more questions? Okay.